Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Write for Your Life, a guide to clear and purposeful writing and presentations by Charles Wheelan. Narrated by William Sarris. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to charts and photos present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. How lost is he? About a decade ago, I went skiing in Colorado with my family. I was entrusted for the day with my nephew, Nate, who was 8 years old at the time. After lunch, Nate asked if he could ski on his own, which seemed like a reasonable request. I pointed to a pine tree near one of the chairlifts. "Meet me under that tree at 4 o'clock," I instructed. Nate skied off to the lift line. At 4 o'clock, I returned to our designated rendezvous point. Nate was not waiting by the pine tree. 15 minutes later, he still had not returned. I was mildly concerned. Had I lost someone else's child? More minutes went by, and Nate still had not turned up. Now I was worried enough that I decided to report Nate missing to the ski patrol. If something terrible had happened, if Nate had broken his leg and been airlifted to a Denver hospital, the ski patrol would know. I found the ski patrol office, where a man behind a desk appeared to be wrapping up work for the day. "How can I help you?" he asked. "I've lost a child," I said. The man sized me up for a moment and then asked, "How lost is he?" Technically, that phrase is ungrammatical. Lost is a binary condition. Something is either lost or not lost. Nothing can be more lost or less lost. Either I knew where Nate was or I did not. In this moment, as I stood plaintively in front of the ski patrol officer, I did not know where Nate was. Yet the ski patrolman's question, "How lost is he?" was a brilliant use of language. With just 4 words, this gentleman told me a number of things. First, he signaled that Nate was not seriously hurt. If there were an injured child lying on a cot in the ski patrol center, the ski patrolman would have asked me, "What's his name?" Or if Nate were so seriously hurt that he was unconscious as they airlifted him to Denver, the ski patrolman might have asked, "Is he a boy with dark hair and a blue coat who looks to be about 8 years old?" This gentleman did not ask any of those things. Instead, his question, just 4 words, suggested something more reassuring. Young people get lost every day at a ski resort, and they get lost in different kinds of ways. There is lost when two men jump out of a white van, nab a child, and race away, tires screeching. That kind of incident is rare, bordering on non-existent. And there is lost when a young, semi-responsible boy who might be tempted to take an extra run does not show up at the appointed time. As I reflected on the question, I knew Nate was the second kind of lost. I was not processing these thoughts consciously. Rather, they were racing through my mind subconsciously, which was the genius of the question, "How lost is he?" I answered, "Not very lost." The ski patrolman nodded in a friendly, unconcerned way. "Why don't you go back to where you said you'd meet him and see if he's there?" he advised. I walked back to the pine tree, where Nate was waiting patiently for me. Language is how we interact with other humans. Words matter. Politicians use language to sell their ideas and capabilities. Hope and change. With just 3 words, Barack Obama embodied the promise of his presidency. "Make America Great Again" did the same thing for Donald Trump. That's 4 words, and I suspect you responded to them with strong emotion. Journalists write to inform us as succinctly and accurately as possible. Columnists write to persuade us or to inspire us to think in new ways. Comedians spend months or years crafting a joke. One misplaced word and the joke falls flat. Entrepreneurs write business plans to attract investors. Dave Girard, former president of Google Apps and the founder and CEO of Upstart, feels so strongly about the importance of good writing in business that he wrote a manifesto, A Founder's Guide to Writing Well. He declared, "Of the many skills attributed to successful entrepreneurs, vision, execution, persuasion, perseverance, grit, resilience, effective writing inevitably fails to make the list. Yet I submit to you that the quality of your writing contributes to the outcomes you experience as a founder and executive, day in and day out. Judges use language to render decisions. There is a winner and a loser in every case, but those verdicts also provide guidance for other courts. When the Supreme Court renders a decision, such as a verdict on the role of affirmative action in college admissions, the language in the majority opinion is an instruction manual for the lower courts. The clearer the language, the less confusion there will be around that legal issue in future decades. Sloppy writing sows confusion. The Second Amendment to the U.S. Constitution reads, "A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed." I have great admiration for the Constitution, but that sentence was not the framers' best work. What exactly does that cumbersome, passive sentence tell us about whether Washington, D.C. can ban handguns? Legal scholars and policymakers have been arguing about the meaning of the Second Amendment for as long as I have been alive. When President George W. Bush nominated White House counsel Harriet Myers to serve on the Supreme Court in 2005, New York Times columnist David Brooks wrote a scathing appraisal of her qualification to serve on the High Court. His complaint was not based on Myers's ideology or her legal experience. He objected to her abysmally poor writing, which he believed indicated a lack of clear thinking. Brooks cited passages like this one. "We have to understand and appreciate that achieving justice for all is in jeopardy before a call to arms to assist in obtaining support for the justice system will be effective. Achieving the necessary understanding and appreciation of why the challenge is so important, we can then turn to the task of providing the much-needed support." It is hard to finish those sentences without skimming. I've read them repeatedly, and I still have no idea what they mean. Brooks, a wonderful columnist, wrote, "Surely the threshold skill required of a Supreme Court justice is the ability to write clearly and argue incisively. Myers's columns provide no evidence of that." President George W. Bush ultimately withdrew the Myers nomination. There were a lot of reasons for that, but the trail of opaque legal writing did not help. What does great legal writing look like? Elena Kagan is the best writer on the current Supreme Court, says Jennifer Sargent, a colleague of mine at Dartmouth College who teaches legal writing. Kagan is the most persuasive writer, and that's the job of a jurist, Sargent explains. Justice Kagan has an aptitude for writing majority opinions, which require language that can hold a coalition of justices together, like a diplomat finding common ground and avoiding points of disagreement. But Elena Kagan's dissents are where her writing soars. Dissenting opinions are written by justices in the minority, the losers in a particular case. These opinions are less constrained because there is no need to hold together a coalition. They are meant to find fault with the majority decision, often with an eye to history. Like good journalism, the best dissents are often colloquial, as if the writer were telling a story about the case to friends over dinner, says Jeffrey Rosen, the legal editor of The New Republic. Elena Kagan's writing is not brilliant because she uses fancy words and makes esoteric historical references. Rather, she uses the tools that will be described in this book: clear, straightforward language, a coherent narrative structure, rigorous editing, and even humor if it serves to make a point. Justice Kagan cited Dr. Seuss, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish, in a 2015 case involving illegal fishing. She is one of the only two justices in the history of the court to use the word chutzpah in an opinion. Antonin Scalia, another great legal writer, was the first. Ironically, great writing can be deliberately opaque. Former U.S. Senator George Mitchell played a crucial role in negotiating the agreement that ended the violent conflict between Protestants and Catholics in Northern Ireland, the Good Friday Agreement. Mitchell wrote in his memoir that vague language was essential to getting the final agreement approved. The parties had been at war for so long, and the various constituencies had developed such hardened positions that no agreement was possible unless the language was sufficiently elastic to allow it to be read differently by opposing sides. The murky language in the Good Friday Agreement became known as constructive ambiguity. The prose was so convoluted in places that it spawned a joke. What do you get if you cross the Northern Ireland peace process with the mafia? Answer, an offer you can't refuse and can't understand. Writing is how we give directions, file criminal complaints, compose love letters, report the news, pitch investment ideas, complain to our landlords, and undertake most other important life endeavors. Language is the code of life. Writing is how we make that code clear and effective. Bad writing is like bad computer code. It obscures, confuses, and works against what we are trying to accomplish, unless unclear writing is essential to what we are trying to accomplish. The spoken word matters too. Franklin Roosevelt used language to assuage Americans' fears during the Great Depression. His medium was radio. The tool was succinct, powerful, and inspiring language. Writing and speaking are two sides of the same coin. They both require using language to good effect. I have been involved with that coin in various ways for my entire career. Twice, I have worked as a speechwriter, first for the governor of Maine and later for former Chicago Mayor Richard M. Daley. Writing is always hard. Putting words in someone else's mouth is uniquely stressful. I recall a particularly scathing critique by the governor as he reviewed the draft of a speech. "Is this supposed to be funny?" he asked angrily. "Because if it is, it isn't." His word choice was clever, albeit devastating to me in that moment. I worked for 5 years as the Midwest correspondent for The Economist, a British weekly news magazine. My job was to report on topics across the American Midwest and produce succinct stories, rarely more than 1,000 words. Years later, I ran for Congress in Chicago during the depths of the financial crisis. I gave speech after speech explaining what I stood for as a candidate and why I ought to be elected. I wasn't. I have worked as a columnist, using analysis and data and humor to try to explain complex topics like healthcare and tax policy, and I have written books on economics and statistics and monetary policy. I don't know more about those topics than other academics. I have been able to write about them in ways that make them understandable and even enjoyable for laypeople. For all that, what motivated me to write this book is my teaching. For nearly 20 years, I have taught public policy to graduate students and undergraduates, first at the University of Chicago and now at Dartmouth College. My students are invariably bright and motivated. However, many of them do not write well enough to thrive in a professional setting. This should not be a great surprise. Most writing assignments in school are, by necessity, somewhat artificial. Reports, essays, and term papers. That is not writing for the real world. Most people do not make a living by writing 10 pages on whales or by describing the symbolism in Paradise Lost, with the obvious exception of nature writers and book reviewers. Writing for life is different. It requires composing your thoughts in a way that gets your desired response, whether that is laughs in a comedy club, a raise from your boss, a large donation to a food pantry, or something else. This is a crucial life skill. As upstart CEO Dave Girard points out in his manifesto, poor writing can harm you in so many ways. Logic is hidden. Points are lost. News is buried. Intent is misread. Feelings are hurt. Credibility suffers. And that assumes anybody actually reads what you wrote. Remember, he's not an English teacher. He runs companies for a living. What kind of writing for life might you do? You might start a company, as Dave Girard did with Upstart. How cool would it be to design crucial software for a self-driving car, or to engineer a medical device that makes surgery safer and more effective? Here is how you would get started: by writing your business plan. Long before your product gets to market, you will need to raise millions of dollars to fund your startup. You cannot do that by inviting investors to your parents' basement and exclaiming, "Bro, you have no idea how awesome this idea is." Rather, you will write a business plan that explains to investors in explicit detail how your product will work, how it will be different from related products on the market, who will buy it, how much they will pay, and, most important, what kind of return your investors will make if all goes as planned, and how much they will lose if it doesn't. The most prominent venture capital firms get about 100 business plans for every one they invest in. You might be thinking, the ideas that get passed up must be lousy. We don't know that. What we know is that the ideas that get passed up are not compelling as described in the business plan. You might have some modest suggestion for how the world could be made better: a new crosswalk near your home, a change in zoning laws, legislation to improve policing. How do you set those changes in motion? You write to the officials who are in a position to authorize or vote on them. Your letter or email will be stacked with hundreds of other ideas that range from sensible to insane. To move your idea to the top of that pile, you may circulate a petition or write an opinion piece for the local newspaper, both of which will require clear, succinct, compelling language. All political and social change is rooted in effective communication, from small projects at the local level to decades-long national improvements. When Martin Luther King Jr. was arrested in Birmingham, Alabama in 1963, he wrote the letter from Birmingham jail. This was not a long complaint about the food. It was a letter to explain the purpose and value of his nonviolent civil disobedience campaign, particularly to white clergy who had been critical of his efforts. The letter is compelling enough that it was published as a pamphlet, reprinted in publications like Ebony and the New York Post, and introduced as testimony in the U.S. House of Representatives. In 1995, Hillary Clinton gave a speech in Beijing at a United Nations conference on women, in which she famously declared, "Women's rights are human rights, and human rights are women's rights." As I will discuss later, the speech was much more than one powerful line, but the overall effect was to frame the way women's rights are perceived around the globe. It was Hillary Clinton's declaration that jump-started a global movement, says Alida Black, a historian and founding editor of the Eleanor Roosevelt Papers Project. Okay, you may not lead a social movement, and one hopes you won't be incarcerated in Alabama, but you are likely to have a job of some sort. Every facet of that work will require clarity of communication with your customers, with your coworkers, with your boss. For ideas big and small, the quality of your writing will signal your clarity of thought. Harriet Myers is not currently on the Supreme Court. Elena Kagan is. Your writing will sell others on your plans. Dave Girard's company Upstart went public in 2020 and was valued at roughly $1.5 billion. And writing will play a crucial role in your overall success. The white clergy on the receiving end of Martin Luther King's letter from jail became an important source of support in the larger civil rights movement. Whatever you do, good writing will help. Years ago, I began keeping an ad hoc list of writing suggestions that I distributed to my students each term. At first, the list was 10 suggestions on one page. Over time, the list grew. These were not tips for better grammar or beautiful prose. They were suggestions for effective writing: clear, succinct, compelling, and most important, appropriate to the task at hand. That list eventually became this book. Meanwhile, I observed that leaders across a range of fields tend to be proficient in public speaking. The women and men who inhabit positions of respect and authority speak cogently and clearly. They are organized and credible. They can speak to a meeting or a large group in a way that projects competence. In some ways, that is what defines leadership, an ability to use words to motivate, to persuade, to soothe. Britain's Queen Elizabeth II had a speech prepared in the early 1980s to be delivered if a Soviet attack precipitated World War III. But whatever terrors lie in wait for us, all the qualities that have helped to keep our freedom intact twice already during this sad century will once more be our strength. Thankfully, that one never came out of the drawer. Speaking for life is important, too. Of course, solid public speaking is not radically different from good writing. You organize words to good effect, and then say them out loud. In fact, the boundary between writing and presenting is more fluid than one might think. When the President of the United States gives his State of the Union address, the remarks are prepared in advance and then delivered before Congress and the nation. If one reads prepared remarks from a teleprompter, is that a written document or a presentation? For the purposes of this book, who cares? At Amazon, founder Jeff Bezos discouraged PowerPoint presentations. His successor, Andy Jassy, asks each presenter to compose a 6-page memo, which may take up to a week to prepare and is distributed to meeting attendees in advance. The meeting is then spent discussing the memo. Would you describe that process as writing a memo, making a presentation, or both? Again, for the purposes of this book, it's a distinction without a difference. The intersection between good writing and effective presentations is clear and compelling communication. Consider one example of how important communication is to success. On August 9, 1940, Winston Churchill sent a memo to his cabinet. This was a low point in World War II for the United Kingdom. Britain was facing nightly bombings from the German Luftwaffe. France had collapsed and signed an armistice with Nazi Germany. The United States had not yet entered the war. At a time that Churchill described as the darkest hour, what did he demand from his war cabinet? Better writing. The first sentences of Churchill's 1940 memo to the cabinet implored, "To do our work, we all have to read a mass of papers. Nearly all of them are far too long. This wastes time, while energy has to be spent looking for the essential points." Winning the war would require, among other things, shorter, clearer memos. Meanwhile, Churchill used his remarkable verbal ability to give radio addresses that rallied the nation. Even if the fate of a nation is not in your hands, writing and speaking effectively are crucial professional skills. Can you communicate in ways that inform, inspire, and motivate? Can you articulate your ideas so that they lead to the intended outcome, whether that is getting a public toilet fixed or ending a violent conflict? That is writing and speaking for your life. Writing for Life 1. Getting Started. 1. Why are you writing this? The first step in good writing is determining what you expect it to accomplish. Let's start at the beginning. You are sitting at the keyboard, or perhaps in front of a blank piece of paper. You intend to write something. Why? Doesn't that seem like a reasonable question? If you were to stop at a gas station and ask for directions, the attendant would ask where you are trying to go. If you cannot answer that question, even the most helpful person cannot offer directions. Or, to use a more technologically sophisticated example, a state-of-the-art navigational system will not give you turn-by-turn directions until you enter a destination. So it is with writing. We cannot define good writing until we know the point of it. Are you trying to thank Grandma for the Amazon gift card? If so, then good writing will be a succinct, handwritten note that makes specific mention of why you appreciated the gift. making it heartfelt and sending it promptly will count more than anything else. If Grandma is pleased when she reads your card, you are Shakespeare in that moment. A reporter once asked Major League pitcher Greg Maddux how fast he threw his fastball. Maddux replied tartly, "Fast enough." Maddux was annoyed by the question because he was needled throughout his career for not pitching the ball particularly hard, even his fastball. Here is the beauty of Maddux's curt response to the reporter. It called out the fallacy of the question. The point of pitching is not to throw the ball hard. The point is to get batters out. Sure, throwing fast can help, but if a batter swings and misses at a slow pitch that bounces twice before reaching the plate, it's still a strike. Maddux won 355 games in his 23-year career. He is one of only 10 pitchers in history to win 300 games and get 3,000 strikeouts. He was the first pitcher in Major League history to win the Cy Young Award, Best Pitcher in Baseball, 4 years in a row. He was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame in 2014. Fast enough. The same is true with writing. Unless you are writing poetry or literary fiction, the purpose of writing is not to create beautiful sentences with lyrical language and elegant metaphors. The purpose of writing is to accomplish something. What words and images will inspire people to write a check, to march in the street, to elect a particular politician, or to respond in some other meaningful way? The measure of your prose is not how elegantly you describe melting polar ice caps. It's whether what you have written inspires people to do something about climate change, recognizing that a devastating description of melting polar ice caps might help in that regard. This is not how most of us learned to write in school. Why did we write a 6-page paper on cockroaches in Mrs. Thompson's English class? Because it counted for 30% of the semester grade. Why did Mrs. Thompson read those papers? Because she was paid to read them. She would get fired if she didn't, or at least if she got caught not reading them and did not have tenure. College brings longer papers on more esoteric topics. The basic exercise is still the same. Write a paper to fulfill an assignment for a professor whose job it is to read what you have written. This is not a book about writing better term papers. It's about writing for what comes after that. Once you are out of school, no one is going to get fired for not finishing your irrelevant or overly long memos. In fact, if you constantly produce things that no one wants to read, you're the one who will get fired. If you write poetic campaign speeches for candidates who lose, your career in politics will be short. If you write brilliant jokes that audiences don't laugh at, your time on stage at comedy clubs will be short and probably very uncomfortable, too. Hillary Clinton's influential 1995 speech on women's rights began with a clear purpose. On the flight to the conference in Beijing, as Clinton worked on successive drafts, Madeleine Albright, U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations and later Secretary of State, asked her, "What do you want to accomplish?" "I want to push the envelope as far as I can on behalf of women and children," Clinton replied. That is what she did. American rhetoric judged her speech in Beijing to be one of the most significant political speeches of the 20th century. Having disparaged poetry a few paragraphs back, I should point out that Hillary Clinton's decision to speak out about women's rights was motivated in part by a young student's poem that she had heard at a different conference. "Too many women, in too many countries, speak the same language of silence." "I couldn't get the poem out of my head," Hillary Clinton said. In the right place, at the right time, poetry can change the world, too. The architect Louis Sullivan, pioneer of the modern skyscraper, believed that form should follow function. Great architecture produces a building that is well suited for its purpose.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.